Cauchy's Integral Theorem is a really important theorem in complex analysis, and it's most often introduced and proven by using vector analysis, and more specifically, Green's Theorem. But another way to approach this subject is by using deformation of contours, which I think is a more intuitive way to visualize what is really happening. So first off, I will introduce this new concept to you about how you can deform one contour into another, and how it can help you to solve integrals. And then we will end by proving Cauchy's integral theorem. So let's get going. The basic idea with deformation of contours is that you can take a closed contour in some domain D and transform it into another in the same domain by deforming it in small steps, an infinite amount of times. In this image here, I deformed our first contour, gamma 0, to gamma 1 by continuously increasing its radius. And note here that the dot contours are just some of the steps along the way. And to be a little bit more precise, we say that a loop, which is another name for a closed contour, gamma 0, can be continuously deformed into another loop, gamma 1, in the domain D, if the loop gamma 0, and here I want you to think about the loop as an elastic string with orientation that you can mold and deform as you like, can be continuously moved about the plane without leaving the domain D, so that it coincides with gamma 1, both in position and in orientation. And here I really want to emphasize that you can mold and deform a loop to your liking. Let's say for example that you have two loops inside some domain D, which has a hole in the bottom left corner. The first loop, gamma 0, is a circle, and the second loop is a triangle. There is absolutely nothing that stops you to take your first loop, gamma 0, and deform it to make it more and more like a triangle for each step. And while doing this, we can for each step move it closer and closer to gamma 1. And by doing this, we have managed to continuously deform our first loop gamma 0 into gamma 1. But if we try to do the same thing in this domain here, where the only difference is that the hole has been moved, then we will notice that we will have to cross this hole at some point while doing the deformation. Which means that we could not deform the loop gamma 0 into the loop gamma 1, since we had to leave the domain D. The key takeaway so far is that when you want to deform one loop into another, you have to first create this set that contains an infinite amount of loops from gamma 0 to gamma 1, where each pair of these loops are sufficient close to each other. And the second thing is that you can reform all you like, as long as you are never leaving the domain D. We can formalize everything we have talked about so far into the following definition. A loop gamma 0 is said to be continuously deformable to the loop gamma 1 in the domain D if there exists a function that is continuous for s values between 0 and 1 and t values between 0 and 1, and satisfies the following three conditions. For each s value, the function needs to parameterize a loop gamma s in the domain D. And then the function should, for s is equal to 0, parameterize the loop gamma 0. And when s is equal to 1, it should parameterize the loop gamma 1. Here I would like us to show that the loop gamma 0 can be continuously deformed to the loop gamma 1 in the domain consisting of the whole complex plane. By drawing the two loops, we can note that gamma 0 is a circle with radius 1 and gamma 1 is a circle with radius 2. So I should be able to deform it by continuously increasing the radius of the inner loop. But to be able to prove that this deformation actually exists, we need a function that describes all these loops. And since all the loops are circles that are centered on the origin, just with different radiuses between 1 and 2, I should be able to describe them all with the help of the following function. And here you can also note that if we insert s is equal to 0, into this function, we get the following, which is equal to gamma 0. And if you instead insert s is equal to 1, you get gamma 1. So, since this function describes all the loops we need, and all the loops are contained inside the domain D, since the domain is the whole complex plane, we can safely say that the loop gamma 0 can be continuously deformed to the loop gamma 1 by using this function. In our next example, we are going to show that any loop in the domain consisting of a whole complex plane can be shrunk to the point contour, which is simply C is equal to 0. So let's say we have an arbitrary loop here. We don't know exactly the expression for it, but let's say that we can parameterize it by using this function here. Then the shrinking to a single point can be achieved by multiplying this parameterization by a scaling factor that varies between 1 to 0. And the function is therefore given by the following expression. And here you can also note that if you insert s is equal to 0, you get the loop we started with. And if you insert s is equal to 1, you get the point. So here we are proving that we can take any loop in this domain and shrink it to a single point. And there are actually many different domains that fulfills this property. We say that any domain D possessing the property that every loop in this domain can be continuously deformed to a point is called a simply connected domain. And since we are working with domains that are two-dimensional, we can simplify this to say that a simply connected domain is a domain without holes. Since if you have a loop that surrounds this hole, that loop can never be deformed to a single point. So by using this new definition, we can state if the following domains are simply connected or not. The first domain have no holes, so that one is simply connected. The second one has a hole, so that is not simply connected. The third one has no holes, so that is simply connected. And the last one has multiple holes, so that is not simply connected. Our next theorem is our main theorem for this lecture, and it tells us why we would even want to deform one contour into another. This theorem states that if we let f be a function analytic in some domain D, containing the loops gamma 0 and gamma 1, if these loops can be continuously deformed into another in this domain D, then we know that the integral of this function along gamma 0 is going to be equal to the integral of this function along gamma 1. And this is really powerful, because this means that if you have to calculate the integral along some complicated contour, then you can just try to deform it to a much simpler contour and calculate the integral for that one instead. A consequence of this theorem is that if a domain is a simply connected domain, then we know that any loop can be deformed into a single point. And the integral for any function over a single point is always going to be equal to 0. And this statement is more commonly known as Cauchy's Integral Theorem. And this also means that to prove Cauchy's Integral Theorem, we only need to prove this one up here, since that one is a consequence from this one. The proof for this theorem actually includes concepts that are far from the field of complex analysis. So I'm going to have to make two assumptions, so that we can prove it by only using concepts that you know from this course. So we start by assuming that the derivative of a function f is continuous, and that the function c, which describes all the parameterization of the loops, also has continuous partial derivatives up to order 2. Now we can start by creating a function I, which is simply equal to the integral of this function along some loop s. And since we know that our function c parameterizes our loop, we get the following. The next step is to take the derivative of this function with respect to s. And we can do that thanks to the assumption that the derivative of a function f had to be continuous. And by using the chain rule, we get the following. And now we're going to use the trick that this expression here, when expanded, looks kind of the same as the expression we have in the integrand. But since we made the assumption that the function c had to have continuous partial derivatives up to order 2, we have that all mixed partial derivatives are equal. So these two expressions are actually the same in this case. So by instead using this expression in the integrand, we get the following. And here I wanted to note that our function c describes some loop, and the key characteristics of a loop is that the starting point and the end point are the same, which means that the function at t is equal to 0 is the same as the function at t is equal to 1, which simply gives us that the derivative of a function I with respect to s is going to be equal to 0. So the function itself is only equal to a constant, so it doesn't depend on the variable s, which is the loop in question, which means that the function for s is equal to, let's say, 0 is going to be equal to the function at, let's say, s is equal to 1. And by rewriting this statement with the help of a definition of a function I up here, we get the following, which is the conclusion of the theorem, and also the conclusion of this lesson. Thanks for watching.